Well, it's good to see you this morning. Good to see that you survived daylight savings time. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians. Still in chapter 1, we're early in the study of this letter, which I have given the overarching theme, perfect gospel for an imperfect church. Not just because this church is an imperfect church, but because every church is an imperfect church. Thank God that the power of the gospel and the advance of his kingdom is not tied to our perfection. It would have been an abysmal failure from the start, but it's not. It's tied to the perfect God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Tied to a perfect message, which is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, who receives it. So today we're looking at chapter 1, verses 26 to 31, boasting in the Lord. Boasting in the Lord. You've already heard, as Joshua has made observations on the songs we've sung, as we read that passage in Jeremiah 9, which really is the background to some of what Paul says here to the Corinthians, that boasting is something that should be focused upon one who is worthy to be bragged upon. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Stand with me if you would. And I hope you have your Bibles and have found 1 Corinthians chapter 1, these verses 26 to 31 in your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, I want to give you one. In the meantime, you can look on the screen. Follow along as I read this passage. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in his presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption. So that it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. It's Jeremiah 9. We've just read what? The inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. May the Lord help us today. As we look at these verses, one of the things I want us to be stirred up increasingly about the propriety of bragging on God. I want us to think more deeply about just what it is that God has done in us, for us, to us, through us, to provoke our bragging and boasting and glorying in him. Thank you. Please be seated. You know, this word gets thrown around a lot. The fact that you hear people say, well, I don't want to brag, but, and then they go ahead and brag, seemingly violating their own conscience. I don't know. And it's okay, by the way, to brag in others. You know, when you hear your grandmothers have what they call grandma brag books, and if you ever catch them with one of them and ask, how are your grandchildren, you ought to sit down because they're going to go through them and show you and give you a blow-by-blow. That's okay. Nothing wrong with that. Bragging in your children's accomplishments. It's okay. Not a thing wrong with that. Unless it's done out of pride and it stirs up pride. Because the scripture says that pride goes before the fall. It was pride that got Lucifer cast out of heaven. It was pride that got our first parents cast out of Eden. It's, pride has brought down many a person through the years. So we're going to handle this right. And I think the way to do that is to take this passage here and remember some things about ourselves so we don't get too big for our britches. And remember that who we are of any note is due to, anchored in, and traces itself back to the precious glory and grace of God shown to us as sinners in Jesus Christ. Paul has indicated in the passage before us that we read and studied last week that human wisdom, God has defeated human wisdom by using the preaching of the gospel to present God's power and wisdom in and through Christ. Paul's going to say today that God has continued to show his wisdom and defeat human wisdom, which we talked about last week, by working through weak and despised people of the city of Corinth. One writer suggested, I thought this was interesting, he said, Paul possibly went over the membership of the Corinthian church in his mind as he wrote verse 26. And he reminded them that very few were famous, wealthy, highly educated, powerful, or influential when they believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, it's very likely that when they came to confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we talked in the Bible study time this morning about making the great confession that Jesus Christ is Lord. When they came to do that, they probably lost whatever prestige they had, influence they had, and for many of them, income that they had. So I want us to see today from this passage just these four things. First of all, we need to remember who we were when God chose us. Verses 26, 28. Second, we need to recognize the reason God chose us, or one of the reasons, we would say, verse 29. Third, we need to realize the rewards of the way God chose us, verse 30. And then this should reignite our boasting in the Lord, verse 31. Let's see if it does that, okay? Remembering who we were when God chose us, verse 26 through 28. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are. Consider your calling. One writer said, thank God it doesn't say none of you were. This is what many, not many of you were. This word calling, I would remind you, it's the same word as summoned. Consider your calling. Consider when the Lord saved you. In other words, remember. Brothers, sometimes we forget. I got to guard my heart. I've got to remember that God saved me from the most dangerous drug ever made available to sinful man. And that's dead religion. Dead religion. Raised to be religious, trained to be religious, functioned on the outside and surface as being very religious. But a wretched sinner. A sinner. Inside. Consider your calling. Remember, just take a moment and remember when the Lord saved you. Whether you were young, whether you were an adult, advanced in years. Remember now, I walked an aisle of the Baptist church, my home church in Texas, declared I wanted to be saved. Preacher prayed with me, pronounced me saved. Baptized me that night. And for the next 10 years, I lived as a church member on my way to hell. Remember, what you were. And rejoice. That God didn't, I'm so thankful, he didn't look at me and say, well, okay, the Ascol kid's got a mama that's really remarkable and got a dad that's pretty much worthless. And he's more like his dad than probably he's willing to admit. This is going to be a disaster. Nothing about this kid makes a compelling case to save him. I don't know where you were, what your upbringing was. Some of you here have told me that you had no religious upbringing, no context, no background. Wherever you were on the spectrum, thank God that he did not measure you on your merits. That's what Paul's saying. Why is he saying this, by the way? He still has operating in the background this word that's come to him about the divisions that are among them. And as he is going after that, he's basically saying, guys, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? You see, God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. This is why the world, by and large, just dismisses God. He doesn't operate the way the world operates. Just would remind you quickly, you know, back when the previous administration came into office, and we were told that this, the people assembled in the cabinet, this was the dream team of academic eggheads, that nobody had been smarter to serve in the previous administration's cabinet. Now we're told that the folks being put into this cabinet, these are the leaders, these guys are successful, these people are shapers, movers. And that impresses people. God's not impressed by that. In fact, Isaiah says at the end of the book of Isaiah, the prophecy, he says, God is searching to and fro across the world, looking to find someone who has a broken and contrite heart and who trembles at his word. I promise you, President Trump's not looking for anybody like that. That's how God works. We need to remember who we were and thank God that what we had that was against us, or the shortage of stuff we had to commend us, was not the determining factor that God used to save us. Second thing we need to see is the reason God chose us. Now, I say the reason. You know, there are reasons. Some tied up in the mystery of God's mind. One of these is laid out here, though. After Jesus had prayed in Matthew 11:25. Remember that? I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you've hidden these things from the wise and the learned and revealed them to babes, little children. He goes on and says, even so, this seemed good in your sight. We pick up in Ephesians 1 that he does all things according to the praise of the knowledge of his grace, the praise of the knowledge of his glory. You see, it's some of it's captured in the heart and mind of God, and we will not know it. But here, this is fascinating. He says in verse 29, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. Why does he do it the way he does it? I actually talked to a young man years, it's been decades ago now. And I had to really rebuke him. He was somewhat devastated, but he was a proud, proud young man. And he said this to me. He said, you know, he said, I've looked at this Christianity stuff for a while, and I've decided that I'm gonna give myself to it. Because I figure God can use folks like me. He said, you know, I'm not going to be one of those just average Christians, though. I'm going to go all in. Because I figure if it's worth it at all, it's worth going all in. In fact, I might even become a pastor. That was his testimony. It's one of the most shocking things I'd ever heard to come out of a young man's mouth. And I told him, I said, you know, I said, the Bible talks about people who, by what they say, you could observe, you know, this person's not far from the kingdom. I said, what you've just told me is that you're far from the kingdom. And I told him about the narrow way and the small gate in Matthew 7, and how you can't come into the kingdom of God bringing all your accolades. It's not how God does it. God strips you and me before he saves you and me. Martin Luther said it this way, God wounds before he will heal. That's why it's called a repenting faith. No human being might boast in the presence of God. And so the first century Christians were an interesting group. I want to read you a citation from a writer in 178 AD, a fellow named Celsus. Listen to what he said about the Christians. Let no cultured person draw near. In other words, if you have any culture, you don't want to take a look at this Christianity. None wise, none sensible. For all that kind of thing, we count evil. But if any man is ignorant, if any man is wanting in sense and culture, if anybody's a fool, let him come boldly to become a Christian. We see them in their own houses, wool dresses, cobblers, the worst, the vulgarest, the most uneducated persons. They're like a swarm of bats or ants creeping out of their nest, or frogs holding a symposium around a swamp, or worms convening in mud. That was the second century's assessment because of the way God saves sinners. And I would suggest to you that it hasn't changed much. It hadn't changed much. That God saves the way he does so that he removes from you and me any ground of boasting. We should be the most humbling, satisfied, service-oriented, thankful people on the planet. If we find someone outside of Christ who is more thankful than us, then we have sinned against the glory and the grace of our God. You know Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. By grace you've been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. There it is. See, the way he saves removes any possibility of us boasting in ourselves, what we did. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. I promise you, brothers and sisters, when we enter into heaven, nobody's going in singing, I did it my way. Not going to happen. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace greater than all my sin. You see, we've got to remember, recognize the reason God chose us. He chose us and he saved us the way he does so that we, in our words, in our deeds, in our witness, would cause people to look to him. That's the challenge, isn't it? When I walk away from somebody, do I leave them thinking about the majesty of my God? Or do I leave them thinking about me and my accolades, my works, my fill in the blank? Because he saves us the way he saves us. to show that we're not worthy of your praise, but you ought to give glory to God. We are his workmanship. The word I've told you when we studied through Ephesians, the word there is poema. We're his anthology of poems. When God saved you, he wrote a powerful, beautiful poem of grace upon your life that others might read it. We're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, so that people would be constrained. Jesus said this in his teaching. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and do what? Be impressed? No. And glorify your Father in heaven. The world rejects that. In fact, the world, as the world, will never accept it. You and I will never convince somebody that God's way is the wise way. What we must do is live under God, reflecting God, glorifying God, praising God, trusting God, believing in God, boasting in God, so that a world that's by nature objectionable to that would, by grace, as the Holy Spirit comes upon them, as surely as he came upon you and me, bring them to see their own foolishness and God's wisdom. That's the only way it'll ever happen. So third, we need to realize the rewards of the way God chose us. Notice, so you say, well, Pastor, I've had people say, that's pretty humiliating. I mean, it's, one woman said to a pastor friend of mine, well, that just leaves us at the mercy of God. And he was native of Texas. He said, that's right, honey. At the mercy of God. Right there. But when that happens, when he chooses those not noble, not wise, not strong, not influential, not wealthy, when he chooses those, that attends some tremendous rewards. So as we remember who we were, never lose sight of that. Recognize the why. We ought to realize some things. And this passage here talks about four things. Because of him. Because of this wisdom of God, which is foolishness to the world, and yet which God uses in such a way that shows the foolishness of the world. Isn't that odd? God's wisdom, which the world thinks is foolish, is used in such a way that the world is exposed as foolish. When they call us frogs chirping at the pond. It says, because of him, you are in Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. You haven't just rejected Jesus like the culture does. You haven't said, well, I'm intrigued by my knowledge of Jesus. You not stop short there. You are in Christ Jesus. Salvation is the Holy Spirit coming into you in the new birth, enabling you to repent and believe the gospel, and he places you in a relationship with Jesus Christ so that it can be said that you're in Christ. That all that God has promised to Christ, these blessings spill over to you because you're in Christ. You're in Christ Jesus, who has become to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. I want us to look at this for a few minutes. First of all, believers are given God's wisdom. Not only saved by this wisdom of God that Paul's talking about earlier in Corinthians, but we are given God's wisdom to replace our own. Depending on when you were saved, what point in your life, there was probably a time when you thought there was this stuff is foolishness. Just doesn't make any sense. And to the carnal mind, it doesn't. Paul's going to address that later, a little later in chapter 2. But when he saves you, when the scales fall off the eyes, when he shows you Jesus Christ in his glory, when you discover that there's life for a look at the Savior and life more abundant and free, then the ways that don't make sense to the world take on an air of wisdom. I'm not suggesting we'll ever figure them all out. That's not what this is. But it's wisdom. You see the wisdom of God and how he did it. Folks, in fact, if you examine, how is it that a holy God could save sinful people? I want to say respectfully here, this is the only path it could have happened, the way God did it. Any other way, the character of God's compromised, or man is provoked to boast in what he did. It's the only way. The wisdom here is remarkable. When you are given the wisdom of God in Christ Jesus, you realize the things that maybe you once valued don't have that much value. You realize that this world is not my home. You realize what it's going to take for a sinner to be saved because you now see what it took for you to be saved. There's wisdom here. Furthermore, when you're saved, God takes people, very unlikely people, and raises them up. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up in due time. You see, it's interesting. Being saved doesn't condemn you to mediocrity. Being saved means that people who were not this and not this and not this now can be enabled by God's grace to rise to incredible heights of influence. It's God's way. It's his path. It's his rhythm. It's his order in things. Men are not saved by our intelligence, accomplishments, or human wisdom. In fact, those who trust in those will never be saved. When we receive the wisdom of God in Christ, as I said it once, our eyes are open, and then there's this growing progression. Think about what you've been taught. If you've been a believer for any length of time at all, think about what the Lord has taught you about himself, about yourself, things you never would have admitted about yourself, about those around you, about your world, about his will, about his way, about the future. All this is progressive. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, says the one who said, let light shine out of darkness, is the one who has shown in our hearts this light, to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. So we're seeing that. You see, it's in the wisdom of God that we're enabled by the Spirit through the Word to become more and more like Jesus Christ. We would never have been like Jesus Christ. I settled early on in life just to be religious, just to appear some things, but not really being conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, the wisdom of God. But there's also this progression. It grows and grows and grows. Ephesians 1:17, just real quickly. Paul prayed that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. That's how we would grow. Wisdom and revelation. 2 Peter exhorted us in chapter 3, verse 18, grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever. So, grow. Wise. The wisdom of God. Second, believers receive God's righteousness. This is wonderful. This is the doctrine of justification by faith alone, in the finished work of Jesus Christ alone. This is the teaching, children, that says that before standing before God, unconverted, that our best efforts are filthy rags. In fact, that's what the Lord showed me when I was pretending to be saved as a religious person before I really got saved, was that my righteousness, I remember him bringing that passage to me, your righteousness is filthy rags to me. It's only when by faith we receive the Lord Jesus Christ and we are, as the Bible describes, clothed in his righteousness, we put on Christ's righteousness. So now we're clothed, we're robed in the righteousness of Christ. We are before God not guilty and counted as righteous in his sight. As if, this is beautiful here. See, Jesus Christ has made righteousness as if we had never sinned. And yet as we grow in his wisdom, we're more consciously aware of remaining sin and we battle with it. But in God's view, because we have the righteousness of Christ, he views us as if we had never sinned. He does not intend to punish us punitively for our sin ever again. When we are chastened by the Lord, we are chastened by a Father who looks at us as if we'd never sinned and corrects us because he wants our very best. He wants our very best. And he wants us to experience his very best. 2 Corinthians 5:21, as Paul is wrapping up that passage, he says, For our sake, he, that is Jesus, God, made Jesus to be no sin. For our sake, he made him, God made Jesus, to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him, in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. That great exchange. Josh mentioned the reconciliation, the trade, where a sinner places his sin, imputes his sin to Jesus. And Jesus imputes his righteousness to us. So it's imputed righteousness. We become righteousness. We learn what is right and wrong. Isn't that interesting? In a day when the society is just crumbling around us on the whole moral issue, as we are growing in grace, what is right becomes more obviously right, and what is wrong becomes more obviously wrong. It's fascinating to me that in religious circles, people seem to be losing their way over a lot of the moral issues of the culture. You know, we can stand for life and against abortion and not be mean. We can stand for living as God created you in your sexual orientation, as you were created, and stand against the LGBTQ, XYZ stuff and not be mean. People are losing their way. And yet the righteousness of God in Christ, imputed unto us by the wisdom of God, things become clearer and clearer. That's what's fascinating. I heard a preacher say, and it's just trembled. I trembled at it years ago. This is decades ago now. He said, you know, it's just hard to know anymore what's right and what's wrong. I mean, when I was growing up, there were things that we said were wrong, but you just don't know now. And he was talking about, at that time, the homosexual issue. And I thought, dear God, you're a man. He was in his 60s at the time. And it's harder and harder to know. Brothers and sisters, the older I get, there are things that are clearer and clearer to me than they've ever been in my life. We don't lose that. It comes in more sharp focus because of the righteousness of God. 2 Corinthians 3:18. Paul says, we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. That's what is happening to us. That's a part of the third thing, the sanctification of the believer. You see, we're the wisdom of God, the righteousness of God, sanctification, which is, by the way, instant and progressive. When you're saved, justified, you were set apart from sin, not ever sinning again, but set apart from the dominion of sin in your life and set apart unto holiness. So you're given a disposition that wants to love God, wants to serve God, wants to bless others. And Paul says that in 2 Corinthians. We are being transformed. We talked this morning at the Bible study time about Jesus being transfigured. And Jesus is transfigured to show them a glimpse of glory but he's transfigured also to show them that when they are touched by him, they will be transformed, not in that bright, shining eminence immediately, but growing in grace, growing in holiness. Jesus Christ is that to us. And the fourth thing, I need to wrap this up. Believers receive God's redemption. The word redeem means to buy back or to buy out of the marketplace. It was a term used of slaves. You would purchase a slave in the marketplace. You would redeem that slave. We're going to look tonight in Ruth at how Ruth had someone step forward. Boaz became her kinsman redeemer. It's a beautiful picture. Redemption. Paul says in Ephesians 1, in that opening hymn there, verse 14, who's the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it. We're redeemed. Peter says it this way in 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. We were redeemed, ransomed from these ways of the forefathers, not with perishable things, silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish. Redeemed. In Christ, we're rescued. In Christ, we're bought out of slavery. Finally, let me wrap this up. There's got to be a reigniting of our boasting in the Lord. Think about this. What you were, why he did it, the implications of that, the rewards that come to us, these four that we've talked about. What do we do in the face of that? God help us if we yawn in the face of that. That the one who boasts, verse 31, boast in the Lord. That the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. It's okay to brag about the grandkids. It's okay to brag about your children's accomplishments. But that ought to be subservient too. In other words, why? Why does it please you? Children's accomplishments. It should be because we hope that in our children, if they do not know Christ or come to know Christ, if they know him now, that those things will flow and redound to the glory of God. We brag on our grandchildren so that they may hear what bragging sounds like and provoke them as they grow up to brag and boast in the Lord when they come to know him. You see? That the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. So I think it's possible to brag on people we love in the Lord. It's provoking them to look upward. But our boasting has got to be primarily in him. And so Paul says this, Galatians 6:14, far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. So let me ask you, is God your boast? Is Jesus your boast? Someone says, let me tell you what so-and-so did for me. That's great. That's wonderful. Let me tell you what Jesus did for me. Why are you so happy? Oh, I've got a Savior who's delivered me from me. Are we boasting in him? Does the world that's going to reject his wisdom until their eyes are open, does the world recognize that we value the work of God on our behalf more than we value anything else? It's March Madness. You're going to hear people, see people boasting in their team. It's okay. Nothing wrong with that. All those things. Anytime we hear somebody boasting, it ought to provoke us to think, Lord, I hear that person saying that, and yet I have so much more to glory in because of who you are and what you have done for me and the prospect of what you will do for those who are not yet saved that I pray for and long to see them come to you. God, thank you, bless you, praise you. Does that mark our lives? I hope it does. Paul's hoping it does for the church at Corinth. But it will supersede and overwhelm and remove out of the way the divisive spirit of, well, I want my way. Well, I want my way. Well, I like my preacher. I like my preacher. Paul hadn't moved away from that. He really believes, though, rallying around the cross, which we saw previously and we're going to see again, and boasting in the Lord, finding that the greatest value, will have a settling, unifying effect that will dispel divisiveness in the body. I think he's right. I think he's right. I love you. I thank God for you. There are those of you here that I thank God for and tell other people about. What a blessing you are. What a wonder it is. But it's because of who Christ is making you. How you're being conformed to him. Let's boast in the Lord. He is worthy. He is worthy. More than worthy of our praise and our glorying and our boasting. Let's pray. Dear Holy Father, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we glory in you today. We glory in our Redeemer today. Forgive me when I get distracted, when I grumble. Forgive me, Lord. May my tongue reflect that my mind is continually set on you, who you are, what you have done, what you've promised to do. Help my mind to remember what I was, and yet that was not a hindrance to you to save me. Help me to glory in you. Help me to remember that because of you, Jesus Christ, in him we have wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, redemption. Oh, make me, make my brothers and sisters here, make our congregational life together be one of boasting and glorying in God through Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.